Good morning. What a true pleasure it is to be here today and have an invitation to talk about one of your favorite subjects today, environmental enrichment and brain plasticity. And I could see so many connection points with respect to what Lucy Turnbull talked about before, because this is about the environment that we all live in, and I will particularly focus on the home environment today. But I just want to start up with a bit of an anecdote. I'm a bit jet-lagged because I'm coming back from Canada, where I studied their rehabilitation system and the aged care network, and was a bit tired this morning, so I came in here to explore my inner life a little bit, to calm down. And I heard the guys up in the back, they were playing music, and I said, crank it up. And they did. We had a good time here in the morning. And music is another favorite object of mine and subject of mine. And as you all know, music is hardwired into your brain and is a strong part of the environmental enrichment concept and should be embedded in a smart way in aged care and in home environments. But that's a topic for another symposium and discussion. So I'm the leader of the Hunter Medical Research Institute, and I notice here actually that the New South Wales Regional Health Partner logo is not on there, and we are a proud partner of this new network, which together with the Sydney network will create a powerful platform to develop new and innovative solutions within healthcare, focusing on translational research and most of all implementation of new data into the system. So today I said I will focus on the importance of stimulating healing environments, and particularly the home setting. As we know, the healthcare system is facing enormous challenges ahead, and we all know that, and not the least financial challenges. And we all struggle at the moment to find those sustainable solutions that will ease the burden for societies. And also at the same time, ensure that older people can remain as independent as possible and age with dignity. It's very, very important, and it will be clearly increasing demand in this space as well. So part of this challenge, and to meet this challenge, will require that we have a more active approach to home-based healthcare and healing environments. Together with modern technology and what we know about environmental enrichment and multisensory, multimodal stimulation, we have the best opportunities to actually take control of our own future and integrate the home setting in a dynamic, future-orientated healthcare system. And I'm quite optimistic around that. Working together with aged care providers and transforming the residential care / aged care, and also embed rehabilitation into that concept. For instance, when it comes to stroke rehabilitation, we have a lot of data nowadays supporting that the true rehab journey doesn't start until the patient is coming home. Not even in the best rehabilitation settings, where we are stressed, we have not landed, we are not coping particularly well. So the discharge, we have different models for the discharge into the home setting, as you can see here. And we are only in the beginning to understand and explore these opportunities. But a couple of recent studies strongly indicate that the true rehabilitation is really initiated in the home setting. And we are not geared and we are not designed to look after that fantastic potential that we have in the home setting. And particularly when you talk about neurological conditions, we are not at all stimulating the individuals to their full potential. In fact, we're not even close. Just to repeat, the flow here from acute to residential care and to home care, as you could, of course it comes out as quite natural and very clear that you have a higher quality of life in your home setting, but it's also cheaper to find the solutions in the home compared to acute care. And we need to, as we said in the beginning here, we need to find the more cost-efficient, cost-effective solutions for the future and rethink the value of the home care and develop that further. Here's a couple of aspects on home health of the future, some frameworks and capabilities that we need to have involved. As I said, I touched upon technology. We need to ensure that we have high quality delivery of healthcare. We need to upskill the community healthcare actors and even the ambulance service, I believe, as the first line of care, the emergency side of care. They need an upskill to be able to maybe to sort out some initial problem, coupled to telemedicine, coupled to new opportunities where we have pre-hospital opportunities and care. And there should be a dynamic flow between the different healthcare providers and the home setting, and as we can see here, with the home as a dynamic part of it. The families and the carers in this model as well, they are very important, and they need to be educated, they need to be upskilled and be a part of this development. They are already, but with a more focused approach, we can gain a lot more. We talked about healing environments, and the built environment has, generally speaking, the ability to change the way people feel, how they behave, and how they heal in both positive and harmful ways. This environment provides a space that is restorative, and it can contribute positively to the physical and psychological needs of the patient and the individual. And what is this about? Yeah, it's a stimulation of the senses. And as you know, the five traditional senses, like seeing, hearing, smelling, touching, tasting, and in addition to that, 15, 20 more senses that we human beings can play on, like thermal, pain, vibration, hunger, etc. They are all means and all senses for the brain. Brain is in the center here, and brain health. The brain registers the surrounding and acts, control the body, control health, control the immune system. So they are all sensors, and the information is brought back into the central nervous system and is digested, and action will be taken out of the information that reached the brain. Enriched environment is a quite established and old concept now, originally introduced by Donald Hebb when he brought home his rats and raised them as pets in his apartment. And he finally figured out that these rats, they were a lot smarter and they had longer lifespan. And he conceptualized the whole model of enriched environment, which he described as a combination of a complex inanimate and social interaction, combination of factors that I said, multisensory stimulation, and it's also activity dependent. And this plays on the tune of brain plasticity. Brain plasticity is an active, ongoing process all through our lives that can help us fight disease, build up brain resilience, and prevent diseases. And this is a typical design of an enriched environment. It was further developed by Mark Rosenzweig in the 1960s. And you can see this is the animals Disneyland. They play, they climb, they nest, and they heal dramatically quicker than if you had animals in a less stimulating environment. And we, as I said, neural plasticity, enriched environment is influencing in a very powerful way the neural plasticity this intrinsic property that make it possible for us to adapt to environmental challenges. And as I said, it's not static, and you can stimulate the brain plasticity through complex environment, through joy, to motivation, and all of this that makes us, in a way, human beings, and includes relearning as well. After a stroke, after brain trauma, you need to relearn and you need to reorganize your central nervous system. Enriched environment and multisensory stimulation is a very powerful way of inducing such changes. So here are just a couple of examples of what we observe after environmental enrichment. We see sort of activities at from the gene all the way up to the functional systemic level, and it's really truly powerful, and it's a non-pharmacological intervention. So we talk about sensory experience-driven cortical plasticity as a result, and subsequent reorganization, and as an outcome, we see an increased brain resilience. As we heard yesterday, genes and the environment, they interact very tightly together. And it was Darwin Darwin year and decade a while ago where the gene was in the focus, the genome was exposed in different settings in the society, and one big focus at the time was the cultural influence on our genes. And as you can see, one strand here is replaced with everyday activities, cultural activities, and we took that on board. And if you can all recognize my Viking accent, I'm actually Swedish. And in Gothenburg in Sweden, we started up 10 years ago an initiative called the Culture and Brain Health Initiative. And as you see here, we have a mission statement to promote brain health, healthy aging without cognitive decline, and to increase brain regeneration and functional recovery. So we did, and it was a truly interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary approach where we employed architects, designers, musicians, engineers, and it was a very, very interesting journey leading to a lot of interesting outcomes, and I will touch upon a few in a minute. So what is human environmental enrichment? Yeah, I mean, it can be anything, it can be personal, it is personal. But we have exercise, food, social interactions, cognitive activities, etc., as cornerstones. And we capitalized on all of this knowledge and created a state-of-the-art rehabilitation facility near Malaga in southern Spain, where we try to implement principles of environmental enrichment in neuro rehabilitation. And it's really a training camp framed by a very stimulating, enriched environment where we play on the green space, the garden, and the beauty of the surrounding area. And the outcome is absolutely stunning. People in chronic phase after stroke and trauma, they improve in a dramatic way. And this has now been evaluated by colleagues from the Karolinska Institute, and it will be published very soon. Fred Gage, Rusty Gage, a friend of mine, a very well-known neuroscientist who has been behind a lot of the knowledge around neurogenesis and new cells in the brain, production of new cells. He engaged together with architects in the States to build up a new society for neuroarchitecture. And he was early out seeing that the knowledge from environmental enrichment, multisensory stimulation could be enhanced and enabled and facilitated if we work together with architects and designers. And there's a lot of interesting statements and a lot of interesting research coming out from this work. And he clearly states that the environment can modulate the function of genes and ultimately the structure of our brain and change our behavior. So architectural design can potentially change our brain and behavior. We can also look at poor architecture, where we possibly can discuss around the inhumanity of contemporary architecture and cities. They can be understood in a broader context as a consequence of the neglect of the body and the senses. For instance, all of these enormous shopping centers and square-formed buildings with nothing, it's just black, big windows. And recent research has actually demonstrated that if you carry wearable diagnostics and you pass through a green space or a more complex architectural piece, you have positive inflow and you go down pulse, heart rate, stress levels go down. But if you just pass through one of those ugly exterior designs, the pulse is going up, you are aroused, and it's absolutely not the way we think when we talk about resilience and longevity. So it is, architecture can be immensely powerful and needs to be considered in future planning of homes, aged care facilities, hospital, and of course in any urban design. So what we talk about now and where we are embarking into is try to marry architecture and neuroscience into neuroarchitecture. And in Newcastle we are on the way. We are working with the faculty and with design and architecture there, and we will launch a quite big initiative quite soon focusing on the home environment and the healing environments. One person that was early out thinking about architecture and how it can influence our minds was Jonas Salk. He discovered the polio vaccine, and during that discovery phase he traveled around in Italy and claims afterwards that he got so stimulated from the environment in Italy that he managed to put the last experiments together, finally proving the story around the polio vaccine. And when he came back, he engaged with the famous architects Louis Kahn, and they created a fantastic space at Salk Institute, been followed by other architects working with MIT. So can architecture enhance creativity? We strongly believe so, without a doubt. Another classic study is Roger Ulrich, who is now working at Chalmers University in Gothenburg, this seminal work in science from 1984, where patients went into emergency care after surgery, and they were put either in front of a window that looked into a brick wall, and the other patients, they had an open view, watching green space, open space with an horizon, and it's unbelievable what a difference after that very very limited intervention. They were discharged much quicker. They had fewer complications, and they recovered much quicker. And this work has inspired a lot of the thinking in this space over the years. This is a terrible slide, I admit, but I just want to toss it in there anyway, because there are some of the areas that we should focus on increasingly, and that there is some kind of research supporting the statements and the claims here. You could see light, color, ventilation, the acoustic environment, etc. It influences and decreases stress levels, emotional exhaustion, etc., 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 burnout, fatigue. And The good thing here is that good and functional design doesn't need to cost more than poor design. There are some good economics around it as well, that if you need to invest a little bit in the beginning, you get it back several fold in the end. So we need to understand this and conceptualize this with a more of a holistic view here, I believe, to be able to achieve what we are after. Lucy Turnbull and previous speaker talked about the importance of urban green space, and my view is that urban green space should be integrated in any care settings. Space for physical activity, exercise, social interaction, cultural activities will lead to physical health benefits, psychological health benefits, and social benefits. And particularly when it comes to stress, we are constantly stressed in our society now, and as you know, and I've heard about, that's not something that is good for your body, and particularly not for your brain. And a lot of data actually support the view that stress can be a contributing factor to early dementia and interference with the immune system, leading to all sorts of diseases undermining situation, leading to vulnerability, and it definitely reduces brain resilience. This is one of the most famous paintings, and I'm sure you're all familiar with Edvard Munch, the Norwegian artist, and Skriet from 1893. You could really feel the anxiety and the stress that this person is experiencing, and as researchers, of course, we want to understand what stress is doing mechanistically, and this wonderful issue in Nature Neuroscience from a few years back, edited by Bruce McEwen from the States, one of the leading researchers in this field, really summarized very well this U-shaped curve, as you can see here. We need stress, normal stress reaction, physiological stress reaction, but then you need stress relief. And the problem is that we don't allow our stress relief in today's society, broadly and generalized. And then you're pushed over to the other side of this inverse U-shaped curve, and you start to see very negative outcome. You see structural change, you see biochemical change, and you are in a very bad situation long-term with respect to psychiatric disease and all other types of disease. And the connections between stress and other pathological mechanisms, of course, is an area of intense research, and we are exploring that. But we know for sure that in stroke, in brain trauma, if the animals are stressed, the damage become a lot worse, and they don't recover as good as they could otherwise. So as a result from this culture and brain health initiative, there was plenty of different projects, including music and dance and arts and architecture and design. Recently, we published a paper demonstrating the positive effect of dancing and also horseback riding on stroke recovery, which was a part of this project. Very encouraging. And we talked about hits on internet. That publication and that press after that publication, it reached about 300 million people around the world. So that was pretty impressive, and we were very happy about that because it was a positive message coming out from that study. This healing environments, this is psychiatry in Borås, outside Gothenburg in Sweden, and as you can see here, we have a strong focus on inside, outside. We bring in the green space into the healthcare setting, and we also have natural timber, we have light, And it's easy to navigate in this space, which is another important matter. And here are some other examples where water is adding to this healing approach as well, this calming approach. And again, a theme where we have inside, outside, and we have interesting architectural design. And interestingly, we have a very good example from yesterday, from the fish market here in Sydney. And the architects, they won a really, really prestigious award around the transformation of the fish market here in Sydney. And they state that it's going to be so good that we will call this the third most important green space in the city of Sydney, an extension of Wentworth Park. And you can see it's very impressive and exactly in line with what we are talking about. That will be a place where people will meet, social interactions, stress relief, and very interesting, cognitively challenging as well. So I think this Sydney approach, I will round off and stop there, and I will just promote a recent publication in Oxford Textbook of Nature and Public Health, where we wrote up a chapter, and I believe perhaps that Dr. Heidi Jansen is here in the audience today, I'm not sure. But she's a fantastic researcher exploring the environmental enrichment in different settings, and we will continue to do so. So thank you very much for listening. Thank you.